So, anyway, I told him that we're kind of going, oh, you guys cast.
It's ready, you just got 50 upvotes.
Yeah, you just got 50 upvotes.
I'm just going to make a game now.
Now, if I hope this is recording. You should have seen the face on the cat. It was like, what the hell? So,
that's a million hits right there.
All right, let me go ahead and go.
Yeah, is that 30-second clip go viral?
All right, anyway, is this, did I end up getting this thing recording? Yeah, looks like it. I'm going to end up being off camera just because of where our seating is. We've got people stretched all the way around that you can't even see. There's probably about, 20 of us in here, 25. So, reasonably decent group. I told them that, you know, like I told you, we'll just start off kind of, tell us a little bit about yourself for those that don't know, and not about the shower. We don't need to hear any more about that. You know, who, what, where, you know, of the indie stuff that you've had, and you can feel free to brag. So, and just kind of, you know, where you are at now, just ended up there, and we'll kind of wing it after that. So,
right. So about 20 minutes ago, I turned the hot water on. did not shampoo today. Didn't even soap up. Really just got wet. All right. I've been indie for over 7 years now. I quit my last real paying job in November 2004. Before that, I was in the big budget gaming industry for about 5 years. I had my first job in the big budget world in 1998 as an intern level designer at a place called Presto Studios. They're probably best known for the earlier work. The Journeyman Project was their series. They did Myst 3. I ended up working there on a game called Whacked, which actually was the first Xbox Live, the first online console game ever on the original Xbox. I got pretty burnt out with the big budget world after working at another place called TKO Studios with a CEO that was embezzling money to pay for his stripper girlfriend. I ended up going off on my own.
Andy, do you know Bobby Steele?
Bobby Steele, no.
Because he worked there too.
at TKO?
I'm pretty sure that was one of Bobby's many stories. Bobby was a guy, he's in Fresno now, but his claim to fame was that over the course of 10 years, every single studio that he worked at went out of business after he arrived.
We did have a couple of satellite studios that we ended up buying out, but he wasn't at the main Santa Cruz, California office, but he may have been at one of the other offices. So at any rate, so I've been independent since then. My first game, I actually quit with the intention of going to business school. I had applied to 4 top flight business schools and ended up, and I had about 9 months between when I quit my job and when I thought classes were going to start at business school. And so I was like, well, I can make a little game in 9 months. And I ended up making that game and getting rejected from all 4 business schools that I had applied to, but then making the game in 10 months and selling around 100,000 copies of it. So that's kind of how I ended up in the place where I am today.
Which one was that?
That was called Wildlife Tycoon Venture Africa. It was a nominee for the grand prize in the IGF in 2006. Lost to Darwinia, which was totally expected. And after that, they asked me to host the IGF award ceremony, and I've been pretty involved with the IGF since then, including winning the IGF in 2010, the grand prize and the Excellence in Design award for a little game I was making and still am making called Monaco, and that game is a 1-4 player stealth heist game. So imagine it's like Ocean's 11. It's all from a top-down perspective, so it's kind of like Pac-Man crossed with Hitman. except it's cooperative and it's got classes like Team Fortress, so you have a hacker and a locksmith, etc. Finishing up, putting up the finishing touches on Monaco, and I'm hoping it'll do well.
You said that 2 years ago, Andy.
I know. Monaco was a game that I actually was thinking that I was done being an indie, because I thought that I wasn't going to make it anymore. I was on the last game that I worked on was called Venture Dinosauria. I was trying to do sort of the third game in the series, reinventing the game each time. And I spent about a year on it and a bunch of money, and it just wasn't even close to fun and certainly nowhere close to finished. And so I ended up taking breaks from it, thinking that I could, you know, take a week off and work on other game designs to try and sort of recharge my design juices, and then come back to Dinosauria. And each time I would do that, I still didn't seem to really get any farther on Dinosauria. And I finally said to myself, all right, you can have one more try. You can take one more week's break and then come back to Dinosauria one last time. And if you can't figure it out, you're going to go get a job. During that week's break, I pulled out an old design that just a paper design that I'd made at that last job that I'd worked at. And this was Monaco, and I decided to take that design and distill it down to something that I could finish in just a few weeks. And after just 3 days of working on the prototype, I realized it was incredibly fun already. And so I decided, hey, why don't I just go with this? Rather than going back to Dinosauria, Dinosauria wasn't fun after a year of work, but this was fun after like 3 days of work. So I decided to just continue on with it, expecting that I could release it on Xbox Live Indie Games in like, you know, 6 weeks or so, something like that. And I entered in the IGF and it became a nominee, and that made me think, okay, well, I should put a little more time into this. So I worked on it for about 15 weeks and it ended up winning the IGF. And from that point forward, there's a whole nother sort of business side to the story that that I can get into. But that's sort of the how Monaco happened. So it won the IGF after 15 weeks of work, which means I've really only been working on it for 2.5 years now, which is actually not that bad for a sort of a big scale indie game. If you look at Braid, for instance, Braid won the design award in 2006 and then didn't come out until 2009, I think. So it's pretty similar in that regard.
We've actually got a guy here in the room Vince 12, who has his game hopefully coming out in about May. It's a retro point-and-click adventure called Resonance. Mm-hmm. And you know,
Monaco,
David.
Monaco beat it in the IGF.
See,
it was a nominee.
you know David Wajidai, right?
Mm-hmm. Wajidai,
yep. Yeah, it's coming out on Wajidai Games.
Cool.
You know, and so we actually had an opportunity to play around with it as kind of like a group play test last month, and all of us were like, okay, well, this is cool. And so, but Vince, you know, in kind of echoing what you were talking about with yourself and with Braid, Vince has been working on this evenings and weekends for 6 years now, I guess, isn't it?
Yep.
Yeah, so 6 years. And so that whole labor of love thing is, you know, especially if you're trying to pay the bills in other ways, is
right.
Something that, you know, the indie space is full of those kinds of stories. So,
yeah.
Look
at Fez. I mean, Fez, it'll be out real soon. It's done. It's not actually being changed at this point. It's in Microsoft's hands waiting to be released, but it took 5 years for Fez. So.
Yeah, and so that's definitely something that, I kind of Borat was saying some of the same things back in whatever it was, October, November, when we visited with him about, you know, wow, this Skulls of the Shogun has gone on, you know, longer than they thought, but it was getting bigger and better than they thought. And then, of course,
right.
They're also in the same situation. Well, the only reason it's not out yet is because of Microsoft.
And yeah.
It's like, we want you to come up with a Windows 8 version. Can you do that? So, at the same time. But, I mean, there's guys here that have been working on, their own work or as a group. We have small studios that have started from the group. I mean, how long have you guys been kind of messing with your stuff?
26 months.
26 months, so that's a physics-based game that they're doing here at Blacktop Studios. You can link to that off of our blog. The other group that you may know of that is represented by a couple people here is Skyvu Studios, the makers of Battle Bears.
He doesn't know about us.
You don't know Battle Bears?
Because
no, I don't know Battle Bears.
And I can tell that because he has Flash video on his website.
Oh, okay. He's tweaking you, dog. Yeah, you gotta play the Battle Bears, though. That's good stuff. Yeah, it's an iOS stuff.
It was like in the top before Angry Birds came out, wasn't it?
Let's not talk about that.
No. they've gotten quite a big acclaim on their number of titles that they have. So.
Is it like they're different species of bears? Like, can you have a black bear fight a grizzly bear fight a petty bear?
Well,
it's all petty bears.
What you described there was unbalanced.
It's all petty bears? Did someone say that?
Bear.
So,
wait, anyway. Someone in the room, do your best petty bear impression. No, not like.
All right. It would have to be Joe.
Something anyway. Like that, right?
Was his crotch off screen?
Was his? No, you should be able to see his crotch.
I think the hat is in the way.
I saw it. Do it again.
All right, you know, it's a Saturday night and you're drinking, Andy, and so
I have to go.
Yeah.
Oh.
Dave is leaving. So I think Dave's making sure his wife is not around.
He's like leaving the room. He's like, I'm getting that.
Yeah, he's going to the men's room. Oh boy.
Oh.
So you talked about the the transition of coming out of what had been your bread and butter for a number of years. I mean, you made some serious bank on the
first game. The second one flopped.
Yeah, and then the third one, it was flopping to you.
Right. Right.
So. How hard was it to put a bullet in that, metaphorically, knowing that you are one for obscure metaphors?
It was extremely difficult, but I would say it was extremely difficult up until I started working on Monaco. It's kind of pitiful. It's like, you know, it's so easy to leave the girlfriend that you're unhappy with when you find someone else that you fall in love with. You know what I'm talking about? So it was the same sort of thing. It's like really, like it sucks to... Yeah, who's that guy back there? He's laughing because he's got one of those girlfriends. No. When I worked on this thing for a long time and I thought it was like the my big game. It was gonna be sort of my masterpiece, that type of thing. That's why I held on to it for a year, even though it wasn't good. But then when I discovered Monaco and Monaco is a really good kisser and like, you know,
with the metaphors.
Yeah, exactly. So no, when I started working on Monaco and it was fun after like 2 days, it was pretty obvious that I just needed to move on. Uh-huh. And it's a little bit cheating because when you're talking about a game which has direct player control where you're actually playing a character, where there's a player character in the game itself. It's actually a lot easier to make the game fun early than it is when you're building a game that does not have a player character like that. If you're talking about a sim game, I'm actually always amazed at The Sims and at SimCity because those types of games are rarely fun until they're done. It amazes me that they actually were able to finish those games.
Well, I'll tell Will the next time I see him that kudos for finishing your game. Will write. I can understand where you're coming from there, where, you know, instead of devising a system, and you talked about this a little bit in your lecture from 2 years ago about, you know, the mechanic meeting the, what was the other side of it, the gameplay.
The experience.
Yeah, that's right. So, if you're doing something that's like a deep sim game where there isn't that instant buy-in of, oh, that's me on the screen.
Right.
You know, it's a lot harder to feel it, if you will, to get that experience across. Unless you have this really good vision. What was it, you say, obviously within 2 or 3 days, you know, you felt that Monaco was fun. And give us an idea, what did the game actually look like? Because a lot of us have seen what it looked like, you know, what it looks like now, or what it looked like, you know, at the magical 15.
It was just a little tile engine that you could run around collecting coins. It was essentially Pac-Man without the ghosts. It's actually fun, you know. If you were to play Pac-Man without the ghosts, just the sort of act of moving your Pac-Man around is actually kind of a fun little act. It feels right, and so that's one of the challenges, of course, of making a game that doesn't have a player character, because when we talk about game feel, what you see when people try and reinvent the sim genre, if you take a look at like From Dust, which I think is a beautiful train wreck, it's an awesome game with some big flaws. They obviously put a lot of thought into the idea of what do we want the game to feel like. We want you to feel like you are someone in the world. This is the game where it's basically like a populace except with geology. And so really your only interaction with the world is picking up the sand and the lava and the water, and then moving it somewhere and dropping it. And I think that I'm guessing, but it does feel like they put a lot of thought and effort into the feel of what it's like to actually do those actions. Whereas when you play a game like Zoo Tycoon or SimCity or something like that, there's no feel at all. You're just clicking buttons, you know? They're different types of games, and you have to think about them think about payoff differently when you're making those types of games. But it is very easy when you're making a game with a player character to get that easy sense of player feel. So that's my thoughts on the subject. Where should we go from here?
I don't know. Does anybody have a question at the moment you want to throw up, or I can just kind of, you know, lead him around through the world of obscure metaphors?
Is there a playable demo of Monaco somewhere?
No, it's not out.
I tried to instruct everybody to not ask that question because I know you've been getting a little...
Sorry, I'll stop.
No, I don't mind. I don't mind when people ask that because they don't know. Actually, the only thing that bothers me is that people, when people... like basically say, what the hell is taking so long? Yeah, I wanted to give you my money, and I'm like, I don't have a beta because it's going to be a console game, and you just can't do that. So the impatience is a little more difficult to deal with when you hear it a lot. But I don't mind enthusiasm for it. That's awesome.
Cool.
Minecraft has really ruined the world of indie games in a lot of senses, in that they he's you know, set up this expectation for games to be released in a playable beta state, but if you're trying to be on the consoles, you just can't do that.
On the other hand, he's also enabled a lot of especially the self-publishing indies, you know, of wow, hey, it's not done yet, but rather than wait for another year until I feel that it is done, I can actually get paid just because people are rabid about what I have so far.
Right.
So.
Yep.
Yeah, yep. And I blame the guy sitting over against the wall over there that you probably can't see on your screen for getting me into that. Hey, Dave, only a week left before it goes into beta and ups the price. It was like, what, two years ago now? And so, yeah, you're an asshole. I can never get that sound of crunching through the dirt and the sand out of my head.
It's funny that you keep leading your own conversations back to Minecraft.
Yeah, I guess I did a couple times tonight,
like,
didn't
it? An abusive relationship, you just can't get out of
let me ask you this.
Why did you call it Monaco?
Yeah, why did you call it Monaco?
It's set in Monaco, but I guess the question then is, why is it set in Monaco? Monaco is it's a principality on the Mediterranean in France. It's a part of France. It's like if Puerto Rico was like actually attached to Florida. Inside Monte Carlo, which you've probably heard of, is inside Monaco, and Monte Carlo is famous for where rich people go to gamble, either at their famous casino or there's a famous Formula One race there. The opening like third of GoldenEye is set there. You know, they go to the casino and then they go on the boat and they steal a helicopter from it. So it's just a famous place where rich people all over Europe come to gamble away their money. There's something satisfying about being a Robin Hood where you're stealing from rich, snotty people that don't give a shit about their money.
Okay.
Do you turn around and give it to somebody, or does the main character just spend it on hookers and blow?
I'm sorry?
Never mind. This is my resident wise ass. He was asking if when you're after you're done with the heist, you can spend it on hookers and blow, but that's GTA, if I remember correctly.
That's not right.
If he gave it to the poor, or if it went to hookers and blow.
They can be poor hookers.
Okay, we're questioning your entire game premise here, by the way.
You cannot spend money on hookers and blow in game, but if you guys all go and buy Monaco when it comes out, I promise I'll spend it on hookers and blow. Just to make up for it.
I'm still having these visions pop in my head of you up at Meganland 2 years ago with your two trophies.
Hey,
I'm so happy.
Meganland's supposed to be secret. Man.
I'm not saying it exists anymore, but that was 2 years ago. The legendary 34th floor of the.
Is it Baconland or Baconland? I just got hungry.
It's Baconland. It's Baconland. Called Baconland.
Yes, and Mandrier runs it.
I'm hungry.
I was going to ask you something. You work out at home pretty much, probably right where
I do.
You sit.
I do. Until I started working on Dinosauria, I had been living in studios basically since I went indie. And then when I started on Dinosauria, I was like, this is it. I'm either going to make it big or I'm going to get a job. So I moved into a place that I was like, you know, a nice bigger place that with a view of a canyon and all that. I'm like, you know what? I can blow some money on this for like a year and a half. And this is my make it or break it game. And here I am like 4 years later, still in this place that's definitely too expensive for me.
Yeah. How much does your wife make?
not much. No, she doesn't support the family. It's I'm funded by Indie Fund, and then by savings of my own. So I'm pretty lucky. When I started as an indie, I had a relative shit ton of money in the bank. Not like I was rich or anything, but I had like $140,000 in the bank.
I thought you had a relative. Shit tons of money.
Some startups happen because relatives shit tons of money.
My grandmother, it was my partially grandmother's inheritance. I'd say about half of that was inheritance from my grandmother, who had a several relative shit tons of money. The other half was money that I'd put away, because when you're working as a programmer in the AAA game industry, you make a lot of money, you don't have a lot of time to spend it. So I was just kind of accruing wealth for 5 years. So I had like $140,000 when I went independent. I've made games and I've done some contract work in the meantime, but slowly but surely that money dwindles, especially when you have full-time paid employees. So these days I'm down to like 40K in the bank, which is still a relative shit ton compared to many. But at the same time, you can blow through 40K pretty quickly when you're talking about actual development expenses for a console game. So,
tell us, you mentioned Indie Fund. Tell us about that for those that aren't familiar.
So Indie Fund is a group of developers, successful independent developers. I think there's like eight of them. Ron Carmel from World of Goo, Kelly Santiago from that game company. By the way, if you have access to a PS3 and you haven't played Journey yet, you're a fucking idiot. So go play it. It's awesome. John Blow from Braid, and a bunch of developers got together to fund artistic or risky games. They are doing it mostly because they just want to see cool games come out, and they're doing it well, they're doing it partially also to try and sort of break the typical publisher developer model, in that typically developers take money up front from the publisher and sacrifice most of their back end money for it, so that when the game comes out, they're not actually making much, if any, money on the game after it comes out, which means that they end up having to take another deal with the publisher again. So there's that terrible cycle that used to be repeated all the time, and these days a lot more people are bootstrapping because you can build smaller games and make a lot of money on them. But yeah, so they've published their deal structure. And in fact, they're actually in the midst of, I think, changing their deal structure. I don't know how much of that is public, but the deal structure that I'm on, and the one that they started with, is that for every $10,000 that they give you, you pay back that $10,000 after the game comes out, and then you owe them 1% per every $10,000 for the first 2 years of the game. Which means it's a no risk loan, meaning that if your game flops, you don't owe them any money. If your game does well, then you end up paying it back plus a percentage. So it's a really good deal. And it's run by a bunch of, you know, high profile people with a lot of really good advice too. So they also act as advisors on the project. I definitely would encourage people, if they have something that's really special, something that sort of expands the concept of games, and if you also have a reputation for actually finishing your games in a professional manner, I would definitely encourage people to approach them.
What other sorts of options would you say are out there? Obviously, you know, bootstrapping and you know, no offense, dead grandparents, is, you know, you know, the traditional way of, hey, I have to be able to have some money, or paying yourself nothing and just doing evenings and weekends. Are there any other models that you are familiar with out there, such as Indie Fund, that you would encourage people to at least look into?
One thing I would say is that I would caution people away from Kickstarter unless you have something, unless you have a lot of contacts in the world. That will really get the word out about your game. There's obviously a lot of buzz about Kickstarter with the Tim Schafer project and with the Wasteland project. But you have to keep in mind that those projects are based upon the reputations of the people that are making the games. Most Kickstarter projects fail miserably unless the project is really far along and has already built up a bunch of hype. So I think it's very difficult to plan upon Kickstarter for someone who doesn't have a reputation in the industry. Beyond that, I think the best thing you can do is just make small games. You really just need to make a small game. You know, my first game was done in 10 months. Or my first indie game was done in 10 months. And it's getting easier and easier to get games done. So, you know, if I really would just recommend making small games and, you know, making some money and then making small games, there's no reason, if you've got a technical background, you can make enough money in order to do this. So as long as you keep your ambition small on the game.
Which reminds me of something that you mentioned in your lecture from the Indie Summit 2 years ago, is when you started Monaco, you talked about how your dev cycle was almost daily. Of you had made a point of saying, I want to have this finished today, this
right.
one thing. And so that
right.
way you always had something like a playable build of some sort with a new feature that was small enough that to be digestible. Why was that important to you, especially at that point in development? Obviously it had to change as you did, you know, bigger and more elaborate thing. But
right.
go back to that time and why was that important to you at that point?
It was important for a bunch of reasons. One, it kept me from ever taking on a task that could potentially take a long time. If you only do things that you can do in a couple of hours or maybe a day, then you'll never get mired in some big unknown task. The second thing is it made it really easy to talk about the game. If you're working on the same task for like 2 weeks, you can't be talking about that for 2 weeks. Whereas if I was working on a new task every few hours or at least once a day, I had something that I could talk about on Twitter or on Facebook or something like that for, you know, every single day, which is really important to sort of build that grassroots knowledge about your game early on, I think. And then lastly, it, from a motivational perspective, I think I've always said that motivation equals productivity, or inspiration equals productivity. And so if you are finishing what it is that you set out to do every day, not just from a scheduling perspective, but actually came up with something interesting to do every day and did it, you'll be inspired every day and you'll work twice as hard because of it. I would say that most of the really great games of the past 10 years, and I don't think this used to be true, but I do think it's true now, but most of the great games of the past 10 years are where they are because of the productivity and inspiration of their creators. And if you are twice as productive as your competitors, you're going to be you're going to get twice as much done. You're going to have twice as dense of a game. If you look at something like the Naughty Dog, the guys at Naughty Dog work their asses off, and that's how they have such density in the Uncharted games. And Uncharted is not doing anything all that new, right? But they're just very dense with content, with high quality content.
If I jump in on the Naughty Dog thing, in a way, it speaks to what you were talking about the digestible chunks, but the accountability and the is that if I remember correctly, because I don't know if you know Christian Yearling at Naughty Dog, and of course, you know, I know Richard Lumbershan, that getting an idea of the culture at Naughty Dog, where they don't have, until just recently on the end of Uncharted 3, they don't have producers. Mm-hmm. Is everybody who is some sort of content creator, whether it be a programmer, a designer, an artist, they are producers. All of them share that responsibility.
Right.
Not only for their own stuff, but there's an accountability with each other. And
right.
So, and that's really kind of why they work their asses off, is because there's that buy-in rather than, oh, there's some pencil pusher telling me that I need to, that I'm behind on some obscure Gantt chart.
Right. Again, that it's inspiration equals productivity. So if you can, if you're working on things that inspire you, you'll be twice as productive and then you'll end up with twice as dense a game. And this is not about making a longer game, but about making a denser game. It's often true that dense is better in games. I don't want to say it's always true, because there's no such thing as always in game design, but it's often true. So working on small digestible chunks so that you can stay inspired is incredibly important.
Speaking of you know, the production environment, you know, when you know, you work from home, you're for all intents and purposes a one-man shop with a little bit of help here and there, you know, whether it be on you know, art or the sound or some level design.
Right.
It pretty much is just you. What is your day?
It's not these days. I do have people helping me out these days, but I've got someone building levels that's also helping test. I've been porting the game out of C# to C++, so I have a few guys from Empty Clip Studios that helped to port the game to C++, and I just a week and a half ago began to work in the new engine. So we're just cleaning up all the last bits and pieces on that. And then Austin Winery, who did the musical score for Journey and also did it for Flow, is also working on the game now too.
Oh, well, that doesn't suck.
Yeah, I know. He's been working on it for, we got in touch about a year ago, and we've been, but really just been working on it together for about 6 months. So.
By the way, Empty Clip Studios, in part, is Matt Shores, who is an ex-Husker. His dad actually teaches at UNO, by the way. I think he's a math professor at UNO.
I think that's true, right? Yeah.
So, yeah, Matt Shores. So, a little bit of Husker love in San Diego, working with Andy there, so... I told you about when I had to. I picked up Matt at the airport like 10 o'clock or 7 o'clock in February, and he came out and spoke with a couple of us at a restaurant. He was wearing, it's 20 below, he's wearing a Chargers sweatshirt. You have been in San Diego for how long, dude? So, what is your, what would you say your day looks like? I mean, how many, you know, obviously we all hear about the AAA nightmares of, you know, the EA spouse and more recently the Rockstar wives thing.
Yeah, I was actually doing a doing contracts for EA during that whole EA spouse thing, and it was all true. It was all true of me, too. It was one of the things that made me go indie.
Yeah, well, I don't doubt that, and there's a lot of people that have said that have left, you know, I mean, obviously Borger left AAA, you know, I got friends that have left Bungie, and Bungie's actually not bad. A bunch of people have left Rockstar and just formed their own studios because they got sick of it. But right. On the other hand, as Borger talked about, he's not working 40 hours a week. And, you know, one of the, as people, you know, say, oh, wow, hey, it must be nice to work for yourself. And I say, yeah, that's true because I can pretty much work whenever I want. The downside is often I work whenever I can. You know, whether it be at 2 a.m. because I'm 12 steps away from my bedroom.
Yeah.
What would you say that your day looks like? You know, because you don't have any other job to worry about. Certainly, you have a wife and just other distractions. How many hours are you working? And is it too many? Is it not enough? Or sometimes do you have to actually push yourself to go and sit down at the computer?
I rarely have to push myself. I usually have to pull myself away. I have to recognize when my productivity is down because I've been sitting at the desk for too long. Usually my body tells me when I've been sitting at the desk for too long, my back hurts and I stop being able to concentrate. So basically I work as long as I can be productive. Sometimes that's more, sometimes that's less, but it's usually around 60 hours, 65 hours a week, I would say, maybe more than that. But I love my work. I have a very simple life. When I was working in the AAA game industry, my one by one, your life gets dismantled. You go into crunch, and so you lose track of your friends, or you lose track of your hobby, or something like that. And then eventually, you just forget how to do any of those things, and so you just end up sitting at home, being like, "Why the hell am I not at work right now?" As an indie, it's a little different in that I don't spend any money. I don't go out to bars, I have lead a very, very, very simple life. It gives me a lot of opportunities to work. So I would say that that's a little bit more by choice. I play a lot of games too.
It's called research and development.
Yeah. I run, I spend time with my wife, I play games, and I see, you know, spend time with family and some friends, and that's really about it.
Try to keep yourself on a set schedule?
Yeah. I do actually get to work. I actually think it's I don't know if it's just a personal disdain at my previous jobs, I always found that 95% of the people that took advantage of the flex schedules were not doing it for any productive reason. They were just doing it because it existed. So I developed a pretty healthy disdain for those that don't get up and work until noon. But I don't know if that has anything to do with anything. But I do get to work at 9 eat regular meals and then have dinner and then work in the evenings. So I keep it. It's funny. My grandfather actually the husband of the rich grandmother. His family owned a business, and then he came, I forget what it was. It was like polio or something. He had some shitty disease when he was like in his 30s, and he couldn't work anymore after that. He got forced out of the business. I don't think he ever worked a day after that. But every morning he would get up and put on a suit and sit at his desk and pretend that he was working because he was so embarrassed that his neighbors might find out that he didn't actually work during the day. Probably some of that got passed down to me too. So I get up and work, or get to work by 9 every day.
So despite the fact that you work from home, you work in a suit?
No. I do actually like wear nice clothes when I typically when I work as well. So it's weird. I have no idea because I hardly knew my grandfather, but I kind of do some of the same stuff. There's some like weird innate embarrassment to the idea of working at home alone. So I do my best to make it feel professional.
I'm just having images of you rocking that pink shirt that you wear.
I wear that all the time. I love that pink shirt.
Yeah, it's great.
If you Google image search me, like 80% of the images are in a pink shirt.
Did you notice that GDC took down the one from all the stuff from last year that had that picture of you and me not looking terribly sober from the awards?
I did not notice that.
Yeah, I was looking for that because I wanted to put it up on the blog prior to this, and they took down all the stuff from last year. At least I couldn't find it. So yeah, but you're right. Neither one of us looked very good. Lots of booze at the VIP party. Not a lot of food. So anyway. Yeah, well, let me go ahead and open it up to see if anybody has any questions. I think one of the things that I would be interested in hearing is some of your tools development. You just mentioned you were going from C# to C++, which I'm sure that Ryan Versaw over here is wincing at because he's our resident .NET nerd.
Oh, so, I fucking love C#. I love it. I love it.
Let me ask you, why are you going to C++ then?
Because it was X and A, and I want the game to be running on the Mac. And yeah, don't tell me that you can use what's it called? Because it's not fully featured. And other console platforms as well. And I haven't announced console platforms because it hasn't actually been fully decided yet. But yeah, the game is now actually running quite a bit faster, and I have the opportunity to go to all platforms. We'll see if I end up. I suspect next game I work on, unless I work on something with the same technology, I'll probably just go back and work in C# again because I love it.
Yeah, I've after giving him shit about it for a while, I've got
awesome. It's amazing.
I have three different Unity clients at the moment, so yeah, it's like, all right, well, I guess I'm stuck with it. Mm-hmm. So, okay, go ahead. Anybody have a question? Yeah, go ahead.
Andy, it's John Franta from GB Games.
Hi.
He actually came all the way from Des Moines to come and see you.
Yeah. Cool. From where?
Des Moines, Iowa.
No.
GB
from
Games.
What games?
GB.
Sorry.
GB Games.
GB Games. Oh yeah. Hi. How are you?
I'm doing all right. I'm still working on my reverse tower defense game. But anyways, I remember your talk from the last GDC where Dave kind of talked about it a bit. I guess what I was wondering is, working daily on something cool or something motivating, how often did that not happen during the production of Monaco? Did you ever hit something where it didn't work in a day and it had to go on for at least a week or something like that?
He's muted.
No.
Whoa, hey, hang on, Andy. You're muted, dude.
Why would you do that?
Hang on.
Is that better?
Yeah, there you are. Yeah,
sorry,
very
nice. A mute button on the side of my earphones. I didn't realize I was pushing on it. The first time that happened to me when I decided to go from a vector-based lighting solution and visibility solution, sorry, a tile-based vector lighting and visibility solution to a vector-based one, and it took me months to convert the whole engine over. It took me like 2 months to convert everything over and to write the algorithm and get it all working right. I'm pretty sure it was worth it in the end to do it. The game's better off for it. But that definitely marked a turning point where I started working on longer tasks. Definitely, I would promote the idea of using that philosophy of working on something small and bite-sized every day during pre-production, during any sort of prototyping phase. And I still try and break down all my tasks in my I keep track of all everything that I need to do. I just keep track of it in Mantis, which is a bug tracking software. So I definitely try and break things down to tiny little chunks. But yeah, there comes a time when you kind of have to bite the bullet and say, okay, I enough of the fun stuff. I need to finish this game now. And sometimes there's stuff that isn't very fun and that takes longer than a day. But I do think it's important at the same time, if you're working on those sorts of things, to occasionally take breaks and work on fun little things too, just to keep yourself inspired. I don't know that it's totally possible to do that from beginning to end on a big scale project, but it probably is possible to do it on a small scale project. So I can't hear you guys now, I think.
No, that's because nobody was saying anything. I just came back from the can, so. Wow. That stuck to the tape. Go ahead.
When you start working on a game, like, what do you, like, start with? Like, middle, end, and you just do everything?
So when I start working on a game, what do I start?
Like, what do you start with? Like, what part of the game do you start with?
So I've made on a variety of scales. I've made maybe 8 games in the past 7.5 years. If you also include Dinosauria in that. Some small little experimental games and much bigger games as well. For the bigger games, I actually have always had a design document. I do think it's important to know where you're going and to know what your inspirations are rather than just sort of wandering off into the woods. It's a bad idea to have too much of a design document because there's no point in having a 20-page design document. But if you can write down sort of the entire scope of what it is that you're trying to build, it probably does keep ambition small. I think that's a big important thing, having a sense of scope before you get started. Otherwise, you're going to end up, you know, running off into the wilderness. It could be that that's just sort of my style of working. So I it's hard for me to espouse it one way or another. But yeah, I do like to have a sense for the scope. With Monaco, it was a little different that I kind of just wanted to work on something that I could get inspired by really quickly. So I my focus changed from, having a design document and then building out, fleshing out that vision to more along the lines of, I do have an idea of what the game is supposed to be, but I didn't actually have an end point in mind. I really just had a starting point in mind, and I was like, well, I'll just build something fun each day. So if, you know, it's hard for me to espouse one way or another because I've done a lot of different things. But with Monaco, I definitely was just working on small bite-sized things that'd be fun and visible every single day. So that's one way to go. And the other way to go is to have that design document, you know, to really get inspired and think about where you're going with it. Sorry, that's a little bit of a rambling answer.
You should have a design doc for the answer.
I tried like 8 different things and they all have their strengths and weaknesses. My success has been varied with each of them. So I don't have a good sense of sort of advice for what the right thing to do is. I'm not sure there is a right thing to do. I think that it's probably true that there are right games and not right games. And in this case, with the question that you're asking, there's not necessarily a right process or a wrong process. It's just whatever gets you to the right game.
Yeah, that is vague.
So vague, it sounded insightful almost.
Yeah, he's going into politics when he's done with Monaco.
Oh, God, no.
Anybody else? Go ahead.
How many folks do you have working for you on your team, and what does each of them do as far as the type of...
One full-time guy, the level designer. And then the other, so I had a contract artist for a little while. There's the porting guys who are largely full-time, but it's temporary full-time work. So really just one full-time level designer that also helps to test, aside from myself. And definitely a big part of Monaco's success was how long I was able to put off hiring people, because it's freaking expensive to have people that are paid. Yeah, the level designer is actually not paid as a salary. He's a royalties only guy. But yeah, actual employees are disastrously expensive.
Chris Journey was talking about when we were doing dinner a couple weeks ago. Because yeah, that whole Kickstarter thing. He works at Double Fine. Yeah, that whole Kickstarter thing. People are, oh my God, you raised $2 million. Nobody's bothered to do the math of how long that lasts on a burn rate for 40 people.
Yeah.
You know, that's about 3 months worth of work. So it adds up quick in that case. So
that's enough Monaco.
Huh?
That's enough for making one Monaco.
Yeah, $2 million would probably cover you for one Monaco, wouldn't it? So he's not Tim Schafer, though. So.
I have a couple of questions about Kickstarter.
So, Mike, did you have something that chained off of what we were just talking about?
Yeah, I assume that when you called in these contractors, this is your first time managing people.
No.
From this point, or like as a lone entity, or.
No. Back in my AAA days, I was the lead programmer on. A couple of different projects, including the lead on an EA contract. We were doing the multiplayer side of GoldenEye Rogue Agent, which was terrible. And then as an indie, I had two different paid full-time people before, and I've been around for almost, I've been around for 7.5 years and had had a ton of contractors during that time. I also did some contract work where I was the executive producer on a virtual world for IAC, which is that big Barry Diller shit-ass company. The virtual world never got off the ground, but we were working with folks from writers from the Muppets and stuff like that. So I've had subordinates, I guess you could say, for a long time.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Joe.
Okay, two questions, both about Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. You mentioned that you need to have a certain amount of popularity or fame or hype already. Do you think you have enough to have a successful, moderately sized, or moderately funded Kickstarter project?
Could I do it? Is that what you asked?
Do you have enough hype, fame, or popularity to pull that off? Do you think so?
Well, pull it off depends on how much you put the price tag at. Could he pull off a $2 million like a Tim Schafer? Probably not.
And you have to, he's doing it solely based on reputation. I suspect if I had a project with a project that looked really, really interesting that people really wanted to see, I might be able to. But even for me, it's probably touch and go. And I'm pretty well known. I have a lot of contacts. It's hard to imagine making more than, say, $10,000 off of a Kickstarter project, and there's plenty of other ways to make that $10,000. And Kickstarter is not something, it's not free money. You have to actually coddle those and you know, build them like their own little PR thing. It just doesn't seem like a particularly efficient way to make money unless you have a huge reputation or something, you know, a video that's getting people really excited.
Or something that, as you mentioned, that's fairly small, you know, for $5,000 or $10,000 or something like that, you can attract enough at $10 or $20 a pop.
Right.
You're going to be able to you know, get
so
that.
So segueing into the next question, that almost right. answers it. Is it more or less a waste of time for smaller, unheard of studios to even try it?
I don't want to, I really hate speaking in absolutes. But yes, I think so. There's some games that can pull it off, but I think for the most part it's a waste of time. I think you're better off making your money in other manners.
Fake sale. Any suggestions on those other manners?
Fake sale.
Yeah, we've got a couple votes for fake sale.
Without hash, I'm not seeing it working.
What are you a student?
No.
What do you do for a living?
I work tech support. Call center. BS.
What do you? Oh, thank you. What's your role on the game?
I'm a developer.
You're a programmer?
Yes, sir.
He's the boss.
So, and you said you work in tech support?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Go get a better paying job.
Oh, you're a big help. Thanks.
No, I know. I'm being an asshole, and I apologize for that.
He's being a correct asshole, though.
No, it's
true. Just check every email you send out and just say, donate to our Kickstarter project.
Day.
And then get a better job when they
fire your ass. Yeah.
It genuinely sounds to me like if you are truly talented enough to actually make a good game that people are going to want to pay for on Kickstarter, and honestly, I don't know if you are because I don't know you and I haven't seen your games. It's possible maybe you're not. But if you are, let's assume that you are, then you're also capable of going out and getting a job as a programmer somewhere, which is going to be a better job than, or a better paying job than a tech support job. So, you know, there are other things, of course, that could keep you there. Maybe you have a family, maybe you can't move.
I don't want to be stuck in a situation like what you were describing, where my life gets dismantled one piece at a time, and my game on the side gets dismantled because of it. The only reason I'm staying is I have good control over the hours.
Well, yeah, but the good news is that if you were to get a programming gig here in town, And by the way, we have more Fortune 500 companies in this town than either LA or Boston. There's a lot of tech going on in this city. And if you were to get a programming gig, we're not talking Rockstar San Diego here. You're not going to be working 80 hours a week.
I'd be working at Conagra or PayPal.
Yeah, or Mutual or something like that. Yeah.
FDR.
So those are going to be, you know, your 40-hour week gigs. And so, you know, work evening and weekend is going to look the same at working that kind of job than it is at what you're doing right now. So, but hopefully you'll be making more money. But it's a rough thing. You know, how much of the chops that you're honing, you know, doing your 3D physics game are gonna. Yeah, and this is my resume for working on a financial, you know, tracking thing for an insurance company.
But the physics are transaction based.
Yeah,
I don't think that'll fly.
Nice. Anybody else? Go ahead.
Yeah, good question. I kind of thought of this when you were talking about Kickstarter a little bit ago. Have you actively started marketing Monaco, or is everything we're hearing, is it just all kind of like buzz?
Oh, shit, Andy.
Well, it won the IGF in 2010. And since then, I've been very active on keeping people up with development on the Twitter and Facebook pages. The Facebook fan page Monaco has around 6,000 fans, and I think the Twitter account has around 3,000. So that's a pretty good core of people that are keeping up with the game. I do also talk to press a lot and get you know, previews and stuff like that out there. So yeah, I have to say I have.
It doesn't hurt when Megan hunts you down to host the IGF. You get to stand there and mention it over and over again.
That is not true. I didn't mention it. I mentioned it once in the last
one. Just once, that's
last
true.
One. Yeah.
So
I always try and stay away from.
How many people were
it?
Watching Andy on the IGF? You were sitting in. Yeah, my son raises his hand. He was sitting in the VIP section.
You didn't finish the sentence.
No, that's true. Who else was watching the GDC Choice Awards? And yeah, okay, a couple people. So,
do you do your own community management? And if so, do you enjoy Facebook's engagement more, or Twitter, or how does that boil down?
Oh, when Facebook started their timeline thing, it sucks. It's awful for community engagement because it really sidelines what other people are trying to talk to me about. I also, this goes back to the earlier question of, you know, have I ever had to work on something that takes longer than a day? I definitely am in a period where I'm in a sort of a lull with marketing, where I'm kind of just trying to finish the game right now, and so there's a lot less to talk about. So I've been pretty dark in terms of interacting with the community for the past year, really. So up until the timeline thing, I thought Facebook was awesome. Facebook is, in a lot of ways, is actually really awesome because you can be dormant for so long, and people will just leave you stay a fan of you on Facebook, and then when you have something to say, it goes out to so many people. It's very sort of naturally viral, although it's less immediately viral like Twitter is. These days, though, I feel like Twitter because I can just I can fire off the stupidest stuff on Twitter and it's expected. So I don't need to. I don't need to have like good content. For a long time, I really focused on the idea of having really high quality content to post on Facebook. So I would actually do like big old technical explanations of things. You know, multi page. They call them notes on there, but basically blog posts. On Facebook, which I really liked, but I haven't been doing them much lately. So, I also do YouTube videos. So I haven't done many of them lately, but one of the things I did early on in development is I would just go for a walk and take a video of myself talking about something interesting about the game and then post it on YouTube. So, you know, I like to say that there's really only two things that matter in game development. One is making an awesome game, and the second is reaching out to potential fans and existing fans. So you don't really need to worry about business. Hopefully, you're in a position where you aren't trying to raise money. But those are, if you can, you know, basically only focus on those two things, you're going to be in really good shape.
Thank you.
You mentioned you had a separate Twitter account for Monaco. I remember months ago there was kind of a question out there about whether or not independent game developers should separate their games on Twitter, or if they should just do like their one indie studio Twitter account.
I do have two Twitter accounts. I have a Monaco is mine is the Monaco account, and then Andy Schatz is my personal account. The Monaco one, basically anything that's really just Monaco, I post on Monaco, and then Andy Schatz is my personal stuff. And for me, it's, I think it's important because if I were posting just the personal stuff on the Monaco one, I would bet that there's actually only a 50% overlap between the two. So I'm able to reach out to more fans with both.
What? Go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah, it kind of touches on some of the questions earlier, I guess, but I've been wanting to do game design for about 12 years now, finally motivating myself to actually look into it. I'm obviously not in a position where I can get hired by a AAA studio right now. And this, again, probably not a right or wrong answer, but would you say, is that a valuable route to go before going indie? Or, I mean, obviously there you have a name and you have more of a portfolio.
So is it valuable to go AAA before trying to go indie? Is that what you're asking?
More or less.
For me, it was. I learned a lot of very valuable lessons as a AAA guy. I also made a lot of money as a AAA guy. So I don't think I would have the success I have now. I also made a lot of contacts as a AAA guy. I actually met Jamil Molodina, who is the original person that asked me to host the IGF back when I was just a programmer at another studio. Those things are all very valuable for me. That said, the indie scene didn't really exist back then, so it's probably a little different now. If you're doing a good job of networking in the indie scene, both online and in person, you could probably sort of supplant that part of it. And there's other ways to make money, and with regards to learning lessons and being able to be a good game developer, there are a lot of people that are really good game developers that have never worked in games, but you do have to put in that extra effort to really understand the craft and understand the technology to be able to do it well. So, but there are plenty of people who do it. So,
let me follow up on that, Andy. You talked about, you know, networking and resources and everything. What would you recommend? You know, whether it be sites to visit or to follow, people to follow, obviously events to go to, you know, GDC being the obvious one, but also Indiecade, I'm assuming, which I'm going to try to get to this fall, by the way. What other, you know, places would you say is a good place to keep an eye on or for different reasons? You know, go elbows deep into it and dig into as resources for not only education but networking. You just want to email me a shitload of links, or
I sigh because I get asked this question a lot, but I don't have a good answer to it. Back in the day, the indie scene was a lot more consolidated, and now it's spread out all over the place. So the places where the mailing lists that I read and interact with, there's a couple of private ones that I wish that, you know, the public could interact with, but they can't. The public one that I mention is TIG Source, but their forums are a shithole of afterbirth, basically.
Wow.
Tell us how you really feel.
GameDev.net is fairly well moderated as far as their forums and their articles.
Yeah. I mean, what you want to do is make games, make small games and finish them. And the more you do that, the more people will want to interact with you. And then have a Twitter account. I guess that's what I would do. I would have a Twitter account, interact with developers that you respect on Twitter, and then make small games. Don't try and make your big dream game now.
Yeah, get something that actually
right.
works.
Yeah, and talk about it. You need to make that small game and then go and get feedback on it, even when it's not finished yet. But you need to talk about it. Takes, like I said, the afterbirthy stench of TIG Source is still a decent place to go plop a game. I'm assuming afterbirth has a smell.
Andy, have you met Dave's wife in the back of the room there?
Not that afterbirth smell made you think of me.
I'm sorry. Wow. I'm just saying, moderate somewhat, my friend. I didn't want to say the V word out loud.
Does afterbirth have a smell? Did she answer the question?
She wasn't down there.
She was on the other end of the table, I guess.
Alright. I bet it does.
This is not getting better. So back to Andy's shower earlier.
We had a lot of candles in the room.
Alright, wow.
Is this getting cut out? Because this belongs in the final video.
You know what? I have fantastic editing tools.
He doesn't even need to cut it out. He just won't release it like all the other ones.
Alright, anybody else have any other questions? What are you using for tools?
Tools? I use this is pitiful. I use GIMP instead of Photoshop.
I use it.
Wow.
Until I started working on the porting stuff, I was using Subversion with Woosh.net is an offsite hosting. I think they might even be, no, never mind, they're not in Nebraska. So I was using Subversion, but now I'm using Perforce. Perforce actually just changed their basic licensing where you can have an insane number of licenses as a small developer. So if you're looking for a source control solution, take a look at Perforce,
because
it's free-ish.
Are you in Visual Studio there?
Huh?
You in Visual Studio?
Yeah, I used Express until I switched over to the port a couple of weeks ago, and now I'm using the full version, the nasty, expensive version.
Yeah.
I used Graphics Gale for pixel art. It's a nice little simple pixel art. Art program. I use Audacity for audio stuff, and Fraps. Other than that, that's about it.
Hey, the Fraps guy, he gave me a free license because he saw I was in the industry. Is he still doing that you know of?
Well, I don't know. It's not expensive, so
no,
I bought mine.
I know, he actually refunded my credit card. I'm like, dude, that probably actually cost you more than what
made you. I'll email him.
He's like, oh, no, I looked on your website and I saw that you were in the industry and everything. I've refunded it. No, because I have this thing where I'm trying to get all the game devs to use my stuff. And so I don't, go ahead and use it. I'm like, all right.
No idea. So,
yeah.
I mean, it's not very expensive.
No,
so.
No.
But Monaco, honestly, I don't think I'd spent a dollar on Monaco for the first year, aside from myself, of course. Yeah, I did everything with free tools.
Cool. Free is good as an indie.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, anybody else? Wow, strange silence.
Strange silence.
Yeah. Well,
Andy, all right, well, can I ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
How often do you guys do this?
Once a month, usually on the third Saturday, as you know, but because you were planning on getting completely wasted last week, you advised me against it, so, which I don't think any of us would have been able to, that were at GDC, would have been able to do it.
And by show of hands, how many of you are actively working on a game right now?
Yeah, we've got a number of people who that are curious and are here for the first time. This is a good sized group. We usually run between, what, would you say 10 and 15 people? We've got probably 20 to 25 here. And there's a whole bunch of regulars that aren't even here tonight. But we actually have, what are we up to, about 7 studios in town, you know, with Skyvu being one of the crown jewels because they've been around for, you know, successful titles for a while. Me, I'm not actively working on my stuff. I'm just doing the consulting. But then Vince, as I mentioned, has got his coming out in May on Wajidai. And then the guys here in front, the Fedora crowd, Blacktop Games.
Normally wear the silly hat.
Yeah, no, you always wear the silly hat.
How many of you have finished a game and released it publicly?
That would be Vince and your guy from Des Moines back here, and then obviously the Skyvu guys. Also, Vince, Aaron Robinson, right?
Of course, yeah.
Yeah. He actually did programming on some of her games.
Okay.
So
cool.
Yeah, that's apparently. It was kind of funny. Before we went to the speakers party, I said, "Oh yeah, I'm going to be seeing Aaron tonight." I was talking to her. Turns out, he says, "Oh yeah, well, I used to do programming for her. Tell her to buy you a beer because she owes me like 6." I'm like, "Dude, where I'm going the rest of the week, I drink for free." Okay, so yeah. All right. But I told her, and she says, "Well, at the speakers party, she says, well, just pretend I'm buying you one." So.
All right. So what of those that are working on a game but have never actually released one? Is this your first game that you're working on, or have you worked on games and then not finished them?
I've worked on a number of other smallish games, like as academic projects, but I didn't count any of them. For me, the release was turning it into the teacher.
Okay.
They were like, "You do so."
How many of you have worked on a game as a hobbyist but then not released it?
You got a handful of hands.
I don't know if I should raise my hand. I turned in my projects.
All right. Well, finish your games, guys. And if you don't finish them, release them publicly. And just to be a part of the community, because it's I think to call Glorious Trainwrecks is a good site for that kind of thing. They did the Pirate Cart this year. The IGF Pirate Cart. If I could give one tip of advice to aspiring developers, it's finish your games or at least release them. Don't let them die on the shelf. So don't come up with some gigantic plan that you'll never actually finish. Come up with a small plan that you can finish and then release.
Susan Gold was pestering me at the party that shall not be named to get this whole group involved in the Global Game Jam next winter.
Yeah.
So
cool, do it.
We'll probably be doing that.
Cool.
And which is what? That's 48 hours, isn't it?
Something like that. Yeah,
something like that on a weekend. So Susan Gold runs the whole Global Game Jam thing, and I told her that we've got a lot of people who would probably be interested on that. We one of the guys here who I'm assuming his wife went into labor because he took off on us. Did she? No.
He said he got a text.
He got a text. All right. Anyway, he's
he's gonna be smelling that soon.
he's the instructor at Bellevue University. Their new games program they've got here. He actually has been in the biz and knows a bunch of people.
Can we verify that he needs to go smell that for us?
Yeah, no, you know what? Let's not. I'm moving on. He ran a 12-hour game jam down in Lincoln that we actually, some of the guys put together some really interesting stuff just in 12 hours. And so we've got some people here who are familiar with that. So imagine what you could pull off in 48. You know, with no sleeping. So that's something that there's a lot of good stuff that has come out of things like those game jams that are actually even, you know, releasable, because they're short, digestible, you know, things that would end up being a mini game in a AAA title. So
I have wasted hundreds of hours playing Cannibalt. There's exactly one button, and you jump to the next building, and it just plays random music and randomly generated buildings, and Coast Entry, where I work, I owe them so much money back.
See, now we're getting ethics involved.
That's why I don't quit, by the way. I do nothing.
Yeah. Man's got a point there. So you should be developing your game while doing nothing.
I'm not going to say that I worked on the game at work on camera. I definitely, for the record, I did not ever do that with the 38 hours a week I don't work.
Okay. That's got to be rough. okay. Well, yeah, no, I think that's actually, you know, fantastic advice. Is if we were to boil it down into something Nike slogan-esque, it would be just do it.
That's not it.
That's the straight riddle.
No, but I pronounced it different than okay.
Just finish it.
I work for Zynga now. I'm just copying stuff.
What about just release? Release is one word.
Yeah, there you go. Release.
Because that also has...
Underneath
release. Release, it feels good. Andy, my friend, I really appreciate that you joining us this evening. That was nice of you. Yeah, you should have seen the enthusiasm that just spewed out of him. Oh God, that Andy showed when I asked him if he could do this for us, and it's really nice. So I'm hoping that it was at least informational, if not entertaining.
Well, we saw the cat in the beginning. So
we saw the cat. Yeah, so we had token cat appearances. Yeah. So no, really appreciate it, Andy. By the way, you're gonna be up at E3.
Yes.
Yeah,
that was. Oh.
We've been bookended by the cat.
He doesn't want to make eye contact.
Are you going to be up at E3, Andy?
Yes, I will. Actually, no, I will not. I think I'm skipping E3 this year. Oh. It's too. I don't know. No, I will not be at E3. I don't think I'm going to be at E3, but I am in the general neighborhood, so if there's something going on, maybe I'll be there. I don't know.
Okay.
We'll see.
I stay out by the airport anyway, out by LAX, and so I'm halfway to San Diego as it is.
Oh, God.
The cat's creeping me out, dude. Oh, shit. All right. Well, again, Andy, appreciate it. Can we show some love for the man? Megan is back there clapping for you because she's married to an aspiring game developer and hoping that he doesn't go broke. So now she's giving me a look like, just shut up, Dave.
I don't know.
Anyway. All right.
Well, thanks so much.
Appreciate having you, man. Take care, my friend.
Bye, guys.
Bye.